what is the perfect murder? It's one in which people are convinced it's not a murder. Tera Chavez, 26 years of age, was at home at her house the weekend of the 20th and 21st of October 2007. She was a cosmopolitan. She worked at Style America there in Los Lunas. She had two kids who she loved, doted on. Everybody will tell you what a great mother she was. Yet on October 21st, 2007, after a 911 call, Tera Chavez is found dead. Single gunshot to the head. That 911 call comes in around 9 o'clock on the 21st. And it's made by the defendant. Calls 911. And he tells him that his wife had just shot herself. Tells them within seconds that he's a cop. And he won't touch her when they ask him. Ask him to do CPR. He won't perform it. Even though his training from back when he was in the Coast Guard includes EMT. Doesn't want ambulances. He's asked multiple times what he wants are 34s cop speed for other cops. And he tells them that he's been gone all weekend. And that she's been dead for at least a day. Now the problem is this 911 call comes into dispatch, but the law enforcement agents that arrive at the scene, they haven't heard this. They don't know of these issues. They don't know of this. So Valencia County Sheriff responds. Sergeant Clyde Joseph responds to the scene. And when he goes into the house after announcing himself, he finds the defendant at the side of the bed, house phone, where his wife's laying dead. He'll tell you, and you'll hear that the house was dark. The only light on in that house was in the bedroom, and he doesn't remember what it was. It wasn't very bright, but he could see. You're going to hear later, the defendant tells you that the only light on is a small TV. The only person present besides Tara's dead body is the defendant. And he saw a gun laying at her side that appeared to him to be the same kind of gun issued by APD. So he asks the defendant to step out of the room, and he sets him down, and he then has EMTs go in to make sure Tara is dead. Has the EMT leave. And then he turns it over to detectives. I mean, he's still there doing some stuff, but the detectives come in. And there's lots of things in the crime scene that, quite frankly, you're going to hear got ignored until later. This is how Tara is found. As you can see, and you're going to hear, she's there. Her feet are crossed. Appears as if she'd been laying, resting comfortably in the bed, ultimately slumped over. The gun, you can see the remote, and we'll talk there. That's how she's found. That There's the gun and the remote control. Furthermore, the room is set up so that the bed's here, and then across the foot of the bed, on the wall across from the foot of the bed, is this armoire, or this chest of drawers. And on this chest of drawers is her cell phone, which cell records are going to show has been used somewhat nonstop for the last 24 hours. It's plugged in and charging. Also in this armoire are the defendant a number of uniforms and ballistic vests. But the defendant tells them that he's been gone at work basically since Wednesday. Yet those are found and photographed. And the gun itself, you're going to see and hear a lot of testimony about a Glock 17, 9mm, first series, first edition. And what you're going to see is that while there were a number of photos taken, none of them are at a 90 degree angle. Yet, when Mark Radosovich, who is asked by the state as a longtime training officer, firearms instructor, armorer, looks at these photos, he begins to have questions. He'll tell you, I can't tell for sure whether this magazine's unseated from these pictures because the Glock sticks out a little bit anyway, but it looked to him like it may be. Well, why does that matter? Well, it matters because, you can hear, that one shot was fired into Tara's mouth, did not exit. She died nearly instantaneously. Another round chambered. You're going to hear that if the magazine's unseated, he was first asked to just do a basic look at this firearm to say, does it function? Any problems? Trigger pull? Did all that. One of the things he tested is that it takes 5 pounds of direct pressure on the trigger release button to release the magazine. And you're going to hear all sorts of stuff about how the Glock's set up and how it plays out. But you're going to hear that the way the gun is set up to work is if that magazine is unseated, the mechanism that comes and pulls another round from the magazine to load it into the chamber cannot do so, does not do so. Yet there's a live round in the chamber, with the spent round having been ejected. Those of you who know a little bit about guns know, you don't even have to have a magazine in for the round in the chamber to fire. Not a problem. Would have fired, gone off. Doesn't load another one. So if Tera Chavez released the magazine before she was dead, a round would not have chambered. But a round chambered and the magazine is released. Now then, speaking of a piece nobody knows anything about at the time, you're going to hear testimony that there's this damp towel on the seat. It's just green towel, still damp. You're going to hear that Tera Chavez called in sick on Saturday. Didn't go to work for the Saturday or Sunday. Called in sick. She's been at home. She's taken the Tylenol PM. You know, she's not like knocked out or anything, but she took Tylenol PM. Yet there's a damp towel on the chair. There's a pair of shorts on the floor. You saw how she's dressed. She's in a pair of sweats laying in bed. Going to sleep. Now, one of the things that's interesting is you're going to hear that over and over again, the defendant tells people, hey, I haven't been there for days. Heck, basically, I've been out of the house for the most part for weeks. Yeah. Over this weekend, I was staying with a lady named Deborah Romero. And if I wasn't with her, I was staying with my mom in Los Lunas. And we'll talk about Deborah Romero some more in a minute. But one of the people you're going to hear from is Natesia Rose Sloma. It's one of the individuals the defendant was having an affair with. It's an affair that was going on for over 2 years. Purely physical, both married, not looking at anything else. You're going to hear from her that, in opposition to what he tells everyone else, he says he was at home in the shower when a shot went off. Now then, you're going to hear lots and lots about notes. The I'm sorry note. Because that's what it says. I'm sorry, Levi. And when you see the full picture, I mean, it's next to a picture of her kids, brand new spiral notebook with pen laying neatly on top. Nothing in it, no note anywhere about how I love you kids, I'm sorry, I couldn't, you know, be a better mother. The only thing in there is three words. I'm sorry, Levi. Now then, what you're going to hear later is that Tera kept a journal. Ultimately, as they're going through the scene, they end up picking up the mattress, and we'll talk about how that happens. But they pick up the mattress, and lo and behold, underneath the mattress, there are phone records, some marijuana, an astrology book, some notes, and a spiral notebook that was used as a journal. Going back to 2004. And quite frankly, a number of those, the majority of those entries are sad and depressing. Talking about basically how bad her marriage is, that defendant's cheating on her, won't come home, calls her bad things, she feels worthless. It goes on in 2004. But the last entry in that journal is months before October 21st. Months. And those last two entries in that journal are, I'm done, I'm turned a corner, only I can make my life right. I'm going to do what I need to do. I've moved on. They're upbeat. And that's where that one ends. And then you have a brand new spiral notebook that's just been begun. You're going to determine as you what that note is. You're going to hear lots of argument that that's a suicide note. Or is it a new journal? Or is it a letter? And she's sick and she stops. You're going to be the one that has to make those decisions as we stand through. But that's what it is. Now there's another note torn up in the trash that we'll talk about. But first, let's get to some of what the defendant's saying. Because see, as the officers come in and they realize it's an APD officer and what they're going, they actually, the detectives at BCSO have a bit of a conference out in the front. Hey, this is a cop, what do we do? Hey, because it's an officer, let's go ahead and read him his rights and take a statement from him. So they go in and they do. And he tells them, I've been gone. I wasn't even gonna come home, but something didn't feel right. Because you see, he got 80 plus phone calls and texts. One of which, the only one he keeps, that says, oh, I'm so sad, I'm afraid I'm going to hurt myself. And it comes from Tara's phone to his phone. But out of those 80 voice messages and or other texts, that's the only one kept. He says he deletes all the rest of them. You know, and after he's been with Deborah Romero all day, he goes straight to his mom's house. So, you know, that's been going on. He goes home to mama's. But then he gets that, you know, something didn't feel right now after, you know, all day. And so he's going to go home. And what he tells them is, I was just going to drive by the house if it was lit up. I'm not even going to stop. Just drive by. I'm just checking. But the house was totally dark. So as he's peeking in, he goes in, light from the TV, and finds Tera. He also tells them that the reason his service issued, his APD issued Glock 17, was left there at home and not with him at work, because he does have a Kimber that he's allowed to carry as well, you know, his baby. But the reason that he left the department-issued gun at home was because they'd had their truck stolen. They reported it on the 5th, a few weeks before this, and so he's worried, so he left it there. Yet he leaves the gun there, and he tells them over and over again, he discusses every possible reason why this is a suicide. Leaves the gun for her protection, but it has to be a suicide. He left his gun there, but he showed her how to use it. He'd taken her out shooting at least once, maybe twice. And it's there because he's scared, because the truck had just been stolen. And so he tells her, hey, if anything happens, just start blasting. Just take it out and start blasting. Because, you know, she's been shown how to use the gun so much. Oops. And as pointed out, he tells them about how dark it is, that he couldn't really see. Yet, he tells people that, you know, at the 911, and it looked like she'd been shot in the head. Well, officers, and you saw pictures, there's blood coming from her nose and mouth, but it's mainly pooled here, and there's no exit wound. So no one was really sure where she was shot until they began to do the looking. But like, I just knew. I saw red here, and I just freaked. In the dark, she's, you saw, relaxed. But just that little TV, just that little TV lighting up the area. Tells them over and over, but I know I didn't touch anything. Well, I might have shaken the blankets. And then he makes sure to tell them that, hey, I have been with Deborah Romero. I was with her all day Sunday. I stayed the night with her Saturday after I got off my shift at midnight, and I was with her Friday night. And, you know, when I left her place, I came straight to Mama's. Deborah Romero is also an APD officer. He was having a affair with her on this weekend, staying at her house. And she'll tell you that, yeah, he did come home to her house on Saturday night. But the only thing she can tell you is that he got there before morning, because it wasn't light out. She makes it very clear that, yeah, well, early on, I thought he probably got home normal. You know, I can't tell you. Woke up, didn't look at a clock. Could have been any time. Other than it wasn't light yet. So from midnight when he gets off his shift to roughly thereabout to, you know, well, it gets light in October, like let's say 5 in the morning. Nobody can account for where he is. But he continues to talk about suicide. He says, look, here's the text I got at 129. Once again, I got lots of other texts. I got lots of other voicemails. They're all gone. I deleted every single one of them. And you know what? She's threatened to hurt herself before. You know, this has happened before. She's threatened this. I just thought she was bugging me. I didn't want to hear it. So I just ignored it all. But I kept this one text. Now he does, when asked, specifically say, oh no, she's never tried to hurt herself before. And that he left that gun there for protection. And specifically he says, when asked about her trying to hurt herself before, it fucking takes balls to fucking shoot yourself. And I didn't think she had it in her. Yet he's telling them over and over again, she killed herself with his gun. VCSO was told it was suicide by the first moment they walked in, from the 911 call on. He tells them that Tara was depressed, threatened suicide before, and that he has an alibi he wasn't even there. But he doesn't tell them about not only Rose and the towel and the shower, but Rose Slama, because she lived in the neighborhood, knew them all, kids went to school, also got her hair cut by Tara. And as she was getting her hair cut, Tara told her in a discussion on the truck that the truck was not really stolen, that it was Levi and his buddies and they did it for insurance. Rose tells the defendant this. Between 1 and 3 weeks before Tara is dead, Rose has a discussion with the defendant and tells him, hey, what's the deal about the truck? Tara says it wasn't really stolen. It was you and the insurance. Now he says, oh, she doesn't know what she's talking about. But he's now been told that Tara's claiming that he's doing some kind of insurance fraud. But he doesn't tell the officers anything about that. He doesn't tell the officers anything about the fact that Tara and her father were making design plans on opening up a brand new barbershop, looking at buildings. He doesn't tell them anything about the fact that Tara, as far back as late 2006, has caught him in multiple affairs. Matter of fact, makes a call in 2006 to the lady he's moved in with, Gina Sanchez, another APD officer, proceeding to give Regina a piece of her mind and having the defendant come home with his tail between his legs. None of that is told to Valencia County Sheriff's Department. So the notes. We've talked about the one on the table, bedside table, but there's this torn up one. It's in the master bathroom trash can, torn to pieces, underneath a birthday hat and cold medicine. And the birthday hat that it's underneath is from little Levi's birthday party that was held October 12th, 2007. So, 9 days before Tara's found dead. And it says, once again, something long. I'm sorry I wasn't a good enough wife. I'm sorry we couldn't make this work. But it's torn up from a week prior. Not from the night that, for this to be a suicide, Tara had to go and get the gun that was in that armoire based upon the defendant's statement, take it out of the holster, go back to the bed, and stick that gun 1 to 3 inches into her mouth. The only note from that night, or at least sometime then, is that I'm sorry, Levi.
Because the end of this night, Lindsay County Sheriff's Office leave the scene having been told it's a suicide and treating it as a suicide. They take some photos, but one of the things they don't do, they don't take the bedding. What you're going to hear is that the Lindsay County Sheriff's Office, when learning that an APD-issued firearm was used to kill Tera Chavez, they called APD. Hey, your gun's used in this. You know, you might want to send someone down. So multiple people come down, psychologist, union, two people in particular, Officer Rick Ingram and Lieutenant Sean O'Connell. Now, Officer Ingram comes down basically because they have a program, I don't know, you call it your buddy program type of deal for grief. Hey, let's get somebody that you've had at least some familiarity with in your unit to come down to help out in grief situations. Now, that was only slightly workable in this case because the defendant hadn't been an APD officer for very long. He transferred in from aviation police, and so he really hadn't been in his unit that long. But so they send Rick down as part of this program. And they send the defendant's lieutenant, Lieutenant Sean O'Connell, down to provide money for housing, things of those nature, because they've been told it's a suicide. So they come down, all this goes on, DCSO is closing up the scene, when Lieutenant O'Connell, whose grandfather killed himself and his mother found, says, hey, look, can we get rid of this bloody mess? Nobody should come home and find this. Kids are coming on, can we do something about it? Purely from a compassion place, because his family's gone through the problem. So he brings up, what can we do about it? There's discussion about, hey, well, you know, it's middle of night by the time this is done. Hey, we could throw it over the fence at the transfer station. Hey, we could. And the discussion goes, look, this is biohazard. We can't just toss it. And so the funeral home says, well, we can get rid of biohazard, stuff. Just give it to us. So they pack up the sheets, and then they realize that on the mattress is this big bloody swatch of a mess. So, hey, how do we get rid of this? And so ultimately, Rick hands a knife to Lieutenant O'Connell, and they cut it out. And they hand that off, along with the sheets to and the bedding to the funeral home, which then takes it and ultimately destroys it the next day. But now you got a big hole in the mattress. So they discuss, well, that still looks pretty bad. It's not a bloody mess, but now we got this big hole cut out. So hey, let's just flip the mattress. That's when, as they lift up the mattress, and it's why they're lifting up the mattress, there's the stuff. And Lieutenant O'Connell said, oh yeah, it was all right there together, towards the, basically right in the middle at the edge of the bed. You've got all these documents. The only thing he could tell you really what was, other than it was a bunch of paper, was, yeah, it looked like a bag of marijuana. And hey guys, you might want to look at this. And so all that gets collected. But Aaron Jones, who's the lead detective on the case, he leaves from the scene before all this is happening, or as they're closing it down, to go tell the family that their daughter's dead. And at that time, it's an apparent suicide.
And as he's gone, or as this, before he leaves, they did do a few things. And some of these are going to ultimately prove to be rather significant. They did take photographs. Now you're going to hear from Deborah D. Hall, who is the evidence, civilian evidence technician. This was her very first call out as the evidence technician. So she took photos, got told, hey, make sure you photograph this, but didn't have the experience herself to make sure, you know, she took, say, a 90-degree photo of the gun. As we've heard, took statement from the defendant. They also collected the home laptop, the personal laptop that was there at the scene, and Tara's cell phone that was across and plugged in. They did not take the defendant's. So the perfect homicide equals suicide. Because suicide, if that's what the officers are being told and believe, equates to no investigation. A rushed end of process. However, in this case, it didn't end. Because very quickly, they started being told, you got some problems with that theory of suicide. So when Aaron Jones goes to the Cordovas to tell Joseph and Teresa Cordova that their daughter is dead by an apparent suicide, Joseph Cordova immediately tells them, that's crap. No way would she have killed herself. Now, not unusual for victim's family not to want to believe that. But he doesn't stop there. Tells them, look, you check in on Levi. Where was he? What was going on? Because my daughter and I, we've got plans. She loved her kids. We're building her a barber shop. She's opening her own store. So Aaron goes, okay. Maybe we should look a little more. And now the investigation actually begins. Instead of, unfortunately, when they show up. So over the course of months and years, interviews of people take place. Some people are interviewed 5 or 6 times. Lots and lots of people are interviewed to see what they know to be given. Now, you're going to see that some of the interviewing technique is a little too informative by the officer. But the nice thing is you're going to get to hear from everybody. And you're going to get to see when they tell you, this is why I know what I know. The computer that was seized, that computer, it's sent to Mike Brookerson, Las Cruces PD, who's an expert in digital forensics, in particular in this case, into the computer. The phone is taken from the scene. Later, months later, they get the defendant's phone, which we ultimately learn is not the same one he had that night, because the one he had that night, he had to send back to Verizon for some kind of defect. And then they also ultimately get Tara's old phone, because see, the defendant had bought her that black phone that you looked at for her birthday just in August. So she had a pink phone up before that. And they ultimately get a hold of that. The gun is checked. It's sent off to the lab for prints and DNA, ballistics. The bullet comes from that gun that killed Tera Chavez. You've got no usable prints and DNA from both Tara and the defendant. But it's looked at. And it's also looked at by Mark Radosovich, as we talked about. An autopsy is done. And The autopsy, Dr. McFeely, the forensic pathologist, the autopsy's done the very next day and says, based on the information, we have suicide. Because what a forensic pathologist is looking at is the body. They make two determinations: cause of death and manner of death. Well, cause of death's not an issue in this case. Gunshot, brainstem, pretty much instantaneous death. Manner of death, lots of different things they can do from the forensic medical field. Accident, undetermined, suicide, homicide, natural causes. And, you know, they're being told, she's depressed, she's threatened suicide, all this day one, okay, and there's nothing about the gunshot itself that could not have been self-inflicted, so suicide. Well, then they start being given more information, things such as the magazine, things such as what the computer is going to show. And they go, all right, now we have to change it to undetermined. Yeah, because you've got all these competing areas as to whether someone else pulled the trigger or whether she did it. So we'll call it undetermined because a jury makes the determination as to what it's going to be. Because you'll hear from her. The only way, even if this jury was to come back with a guilty verdict, they will not change their determination. The only way that would happen would be confession or videotape, since there were competing issues. And the defendant goes from the grieving husband of a woman who killed herself to a suspect in the case. Now then, that's October 21st. On November 5th, 2007, the defendant drops on into Valencia County Sheriff to talk to Aaron Jones. And what he wants to talk about is his computer. He wants it back. He's really concerned that, hey, this investigation's not already closed, calling this a suicide and over and done. But, and give me that computer back. Don't worry, there's nothing on it. Yet that computer is analyzed. And you're gonna hear all sorts of stuff from Mike Brookerson about unallocated space and the fact that when you delete stuff, you don't really delete it until the computer decides ultimately to write over it. So word to the wise, after listening to all this, saying delete doesn't mean anything. It's still hidden on your computer somewhere until the computer decides to get rid of it. And so there's lots of stuff in there that floats around in this that someone who knows what they're doing can come back and pull out. And so, going back to November of 2006, so we talked about Regina Sanchez is the lady on November 21st, is the lady that Tara calls up while Levi's there and says, why are you having an affair with my husband? He's still married to me. He's got kids. What's your problem? And it's actually before that that the phone call comes in. But on November 21st, while the defendant is no longer still staying with Regina, he's still interested in a physical relationship. And that's the date that Regina says, it's over, absolutely. It's not contentious, but no. And the reason she remembers, she has another date that night with someone else. And so, nope, this is it, it's done. November 21st is the last time, made it absolutely clear. On November 28th, 2006, a week after that, someone's looking up on the computer how to kill someone. Now you're gonna hear from Officer Brookerson, he can't tell you who's looking up what. You know, there's no camera that's taking pictures as you log in, although I guess based upon the new Xbox that's about to change, but you know, at least in 2007, computer wasn't taking these photographs of you. But what he can do and what he's going to show is around this stuff, there's lots of different searches, there's lots of different things going on. And it's going to be up to you to determine whether what he provides you
is enough to make a decision as to who's looking up what. But there will be these patterns of searches and things for you to make a determination. Then, from January to April of 07, you got lots and lots of stuff popping up. But a couple in particular is as early as January, you start getting this motif of the ball and chain start showing up. And then, April 10th, there's a search on that home computer for a Heather Hindi. And we'll talk about her in a bit. But as early as April 10th, 2007, that computer is being used to look up Heather Hindi's information. On August 14th, 2007, that computer is used to go to the website for the military insurance benefits, along with looking up information on the F-150 truck and searches for all sorts of other stuff that's going on that day, cars and other things that you're going to look at. It goes specifically to the military benefit, insurance benefits. Then September 7th, the screensaver on that is changed to, as it goes across, I was married by a judge, I should have asked for a jury. And then again, October 1st, 2007, benefitsmilitary.com is once again visited. And on October 5th is the last time, and there's going to be a range as to when these things disappear, but the last time these are seen, as in activated, there's 2,700 files. Now, it's going to go on. There becomes thousands of files that disappear sometime after this that are cleared out of the computer. And once again, Heather Hindi is searched on October 16th. And we got the desktop changing to the ball and a picture of guy with the ball and chain, and darndivorce.com is looked up. Lots and lots of other things, searches for, you know, cell phones and which one would have the best and most secure cell phone, and thousands of files deleted. Now then, those cell phones, as stated, they were taken. Tara's the night of her death. And first, they were given to Officer Mark Lewandowski with the Santa Fe Police Department, and ultimately Virginia Bateman with the FBI to look at these. To make sure, hey, we have things like spyware, have they been hacked, anything like that. Nothing like that is on there. But there are some things that are interesting. Tara's phone that's seized that night, that the phone records will show had call after call with, you know, and the defendant tells you he had call after call and text after text from Tara, has exactly three texts in her outgoing log on October 20th to the 21st. With one being saved, I'm so sad, I'm afraid I'm going to hurt myself. Happens to be one of those. And as far as the outgoing phone calls, because it keeps text and phone calls separate, it only shows two outgoing phone calls on that time period. Lots and lots of them from before that. As we pointed out, the defendant, unfortunately, was not collected at the scene to see, hey, what might be on his. But he does make sure to show and tell the officers about the I'm sorry text, but he tells them he deleted every other voicemail and text. Yeah, over 80. Now then, life insurance. need to be clear. Defendant had gone into the Coast Guard, finished his time, came out, did a term in the National Guard, and then he was in the New Mexico Air National Guard for a few months when on September 5th, 2007, he changes to the Army New Mexico Army National Guard for a term of a year. So, you know, he changes over. I want to be clear. There has never, ever, ever been a change in the life insurance policy. He had 100,000 life insurance on Tera before. On September 5th, 2007, he got 100,000. However, that home computer's looking up those benefits, and then he goes and he changes service from the Air Guard to the Army Guard, and then as soon as his year's up, he gets out. You're gonna see that on the form, it's automatic to have insurance on your spouse. However, you can pick up to the 100,000 or none. And he just left the 100,000 and paid not much, it's like $5.50 a month, but agreed to pay the $5.50 a month to keep her insured, even though on September 5th, 2007, he basically wasn't in and they'd been talking divorce. But let's be clear, there's no change, but there is 100,000 insurance. Now then, why would the defendant kill his wife? When you get instructed by the judge at the end of this trial, nowhere in there, in any instruction, is it going to say, and the state must prove to you that the defendant killed Tera Chavez for some reason. Motive does not have to be proven. That being said, in a case particularly like this, where the defendant was an APD officer at the time, why is a pretty important question. And it starts all the way back in 06, where he's shamed and looking up how to kill someone. You know, probably a pipe dream at that point in time. Just the beginning of, I'm very upset with this, want to find a way out. But all the way back there, that computer shows you that something's going on. He tells Tara she's holding him back, calls her a worthless piece of skin. He opens up a private bank account that she doesn't know about. Instead of the joint, and obviously the joint account's still there, but so he has his own money. You know, she constantly wants him to come home. Be a father, be a husband. Divorce is in the picture, and all that goes with it. Now then, Heather Chavez. Was Heather Hindi? Told you we'd talk about this. You got that search all the way back in April 2007. Again in October 16th. Tera Chavez is called in to 911 dead on October 21st, and by December of 2007, the defendant's buying Heather Hindi a ring. And they get married pretty much as soon as her divorce is final. Because she's still Heather Hindi, married to Steve Hindi. And then there's the money. Defendant became an officer because Rio Rancho PD hired him and paid for him to go to the academy. And in their contract said, you know, you have to work for us for so long, otherwise you owe us for the academy cost, which is quite a bit. He owed on the truck, you know, had house payments, your normal payments. He left Rio Rancho PD to go to aviation police, and ultimately they reached a settlement of roughly about $500 a month he had to pay them on top of everything else.
So you've got this $100,000 life insurance policy that under the terms does pay out for suicide. Defendant buys a Cadillac within just a number of days after Tara's death. And obviously divorce and the costs and the issues that go with it are no longer a problem. And then finally, as to why this weekend, the kids are out of town. They're with his dad in Santa Rosa. Actually, Heather's out of town. He's staying with another lady who, and he's been told just a short time before this about what Tara's saying about his actions on the truck. Let's be clear. This is not a trial on whether that truck was stolen or not. Doesn't matter. Don't care. We're not here for an insurance fraud. That's not this trial. Don't care, has nothing to do with it. Other than, he knows Tara's telling people that he, a brand spanking new officer at APD, still on probation, is involved in some kind of a fraud. That's bad news. So it all comes together on that weekend. When the defendant comes home and puts the gun that he had with him into Tara's mouth and pulls the trigger. Because there's no such thing as the perfect murder. This was not a suicide, because the defendant killed his wife. And when you've got all the evidence before you, we're going to ask that you go back in that jury room, that you review all of the material, that you take your time, you look at it, and then you'll see that the evidence will prove to you beyond a reasonable doubt that Tera Chavez did not take her own life. She had way too many things to look forward to. That the defendant had the motive and the opportunity and killed his wife to remove a problem.
Thank you.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Well, we're finally underway. As the judge has previously instructed you, of course, what prove, number one, what they claimed in their opening, because I doubt it, and secondly, whether what they do prove, what they put forward for you that they that suffices as evidence, whether that's enough to find my client guilty beyond a reasonable doubt. And you know what? You're not going to be able to find Levi guilty beyond a reasonable doubt. Levi guilty is not, are not two words that are going to go in the same sentence. Let me tell you a little bit about this case. Levi and Tara got together as very young kids. Levi, Tara got pregnant with their first child when she was 15 years old. They had been together for a long time. You're going to learn that this is a sad case. You're going to learn that Tara was a very needy person. Tara was a very quiet person that tended to keep things bottled up inside. Tara did open up inside her diary. And as the DA hinted, Tara's diary shows somebody whose self-worth was entirely tied up in her marriage to Levi, who was very sad and very depressed over the state of her marriage, was very sad that Levi was having multiple affairs and that basically that she couldn't win back Levi's love. And they had been together for a long time, and it's true that Levi had affairs with women. It's also true that after Tara died, Levi found out that Tara was sleeping with an Albuquerque police officer. And, you know, the whole thing was a mess. It was a marriage that should have ended long before. But at any rate, getting close to the time period when this thing happened, Levi, that weekend, was going to spend a weekend with another woman, Deborah Romero, and he did. And Tara apparently was expecting that either Levi or some other man was going to be coming to her home that weekend to spend time with her. And she had rented a bunch of movies to watch, and she had prepared a meal. And you're going to see evidence in this case that when the police came and they looked over the house, one of the things they found was an entire plate of food just thrown into the trash. Tara was very upset because either Levi or some other man never made it to a romantic rendezvous that Tara was expecting that weekend. And to say that Tara called and texted Levi a lot is an understatement. The indictment in this case charges that sometime between Friday the 19th and Sunday the 21st of October 2007, that Levi killed Tara, because they can't pin down the date. But that weekend, Levi went to work on Friday the 19th. Let's start with that date, and we'll see how far we get in trial. But on Friday the 19th, he went to work. And his shifts usually from about 2 to midnight. And so he went and he worked on the west side of Albuquerque Police Department, on the west side of the Rio Grande River. And at midnight, when he would get off work, he would drive over to Deborah Romero's house, first on the evening of Friday the 19th, spent the night there with her, got up the next day, spent the day with her, mostly just lounging around the house, stayed there until he had to go to work on Saturday, and he worked again on Saturday, his shift until midnight. When he was done with his shift at midnight, he went over to Deborah Romero's house again and spent the night again. The next day, Sunday the 21st, Levi and Deborah Romero went out. They went to see a movie with Catherine Zeta-Jones about cooking or a chef or something. They went to Chili's, I believe, restaurant. They went to various different places that day. And near the end of the day, when Deborah Romero's daughter was getting ready to be brought home to the home, Levi left, and went back to Las Lunas to his mom's house, and because that's where he was staying. He was estranged from Tera at the time, but he would check on her and make sure things were okay. They had two young children, and those children were spending the weekend, that weekend, with Levi's dad up in Santa Rosa, New Mexico. So, after Levi leaves Deborah Romero's house, he goes home to his mom's house. And he gets there, I don't know, sometime after 8 p.m. And he's just kind of hanging out with her and her husband, and her husband's sons are watching a sporting event on television. Her mom's not interested in that. She has some, I don't know, Desperate Housewives or some kind of other show that she wants to watch. So she goes to her bedroom and just watches that. Levi goes and lies down next to his mom so that they can kind of catch up. She asks him, "Are you hungry, son?" He says, "Yeah, I'm a little hungry." And she gets him a little bowl of chicken and rice or whatever it is. He's eating that. And what you need to know is Tera has been blowing up his phone. Blowing up his phone during this weekend that he's been out with Deborah Romero. In fact, you're going to learn that between the 19th, Friday the 19th, and Sunday the 21st, Tera made approximately 315 telephone calls to Levi. So is it any wonder that the guy's just deleting them? I'm sure it became muscle memory after a while. And you're going to learn a little bit more about Levi and Tara's relationship and what they would do. But basically, you know, she's desperate. These are the actions of a desperate person. Ask yourself whether, if you were fighting with your husband, whether you would call him 315 times over the course of 2 days. That in itself is pretty telling. And when you're going to put it into the rest of the evidence in this case, it's going to be probably in an important piece, but that's up to you all. So, Tera had left Levi a text that said something to the effect of, "I'm so sad, I'm afraid I'm going to hurt myself." And Tera had done that in the past. And Levi was just kind of blowing her off because he thought that this was yet another technique, another angle that Tera was using to get him to come back to the house. So he kind of blew it off. But he did not hear from Tera anymore. The last time Tera called him was Sunday the 21st at 1:45 a.m. And then after that, the calls from Tera just stopped. After 315 calls, it just stopped. So Levi's thinking, okay, it's a little weird. And he goes to his mom's house, and he asks his mom, "So have you heard from Tera?" "No, you know, I tried to call her. I left a voicemail. She didn't call me back." He finds out that Tera had called in sick that Saturday, and it was a habit of Tara's to call in sick when she wanted to spend some quality time with Levi or whoever she was spending quality time with. And that is the Sunday, the following day, she hadn't gone into work at all. So Levi's thinking, you know, maybe I ought to go check on her. And so Levi drives by the house, and he doesn't see the lights on. And he goes to the house, and he walks in the door, and he sees a faint light coming from the bedroom. And as he's walking in, he sees Tera in bed with some pillows propped up behind her. And he's so happy. He's so happy because for a moment he realizes that, okay, things are all right. I was she would actually kill herself. And he gets closer, and he sees that she's dead. He sees that there's hard, dried blood around her, around coming from her face, going down. You don't need a big lit up scene to be able to see the amount of blood you're going to see, and you're going to see it in photographs. Okay? So he knows she's dead, and he sees her eyes, and he looks at her eyes, and he's never been close to anybody that he, you know, knew and loved that's been dead before. And he freaks out. He is so hurt, and his world is so turned upside down. Yes, he was estranged from Tera. Yes, he was sleeping with other women. But this was the mother of his children. And they had a funny kind of a relationship where even though they would break up and say they were broken up, Tera would always want him back. And Levi, for his part, having married this girl at such a young age and having spent so much of his life from the time he was a kid, basically, till the time she died, she was the mother of his kids. He had the memories, the good, sweet, wholesome memories of when they were a young couple, of when they were having their children. And he would idealize, he would romanticize. Part of him would want to have that back. And that's why, you know, he bought her a ring. There were times when he did show her love and affection. And it was probably based on the memories he had of the sweet young marriage and family that once upon a time had. And so both of them were in this kind of a funny cycle where, you know, you can't live with them, you can't live without them, I guess. Well, God, Levi is leaning down next to her. She's lying on the bed. He can't believe it. He is so distraught. He picks up the telephone and he calls 911. Now you're going to learn that unlike the Albuquerque Police Department 911 setup where Levi worked, the Valencia County 911 setup is very different in a very interesting way. The APD setup that Levi's familiar with, when a person calls 911, when the call gets connected, then that's when the 911 call starts to be recorded. And so if you call in Albuquerque, you get a recording of the 911 call. The first thing you hear is 911, what's your emergency? And then the recording carries on from there. But you can learn that in Valencia County, somehow, they've got their setup such that once the caller punches in the numbers 911, it starts recording right then and there. And so Levi didn't know this, but what you're going to get to hear is Levi's voice and Levi's emotions before the 911 operator even picks up the phone. And he is moaning and he is blaming himself. He's blaming himself because he wasn't a good husband and he wasn't there and he didn't respond when she was making these cries for help. And he feels horrible, and you're going to hear the 911 call. And you be the judge as to whether there was anything nefarious or wrong or guilty about the way Levi made that 911 call. It is difficult to listen to, but it is the sound of a man who is in anguish, who is facing the biggest consequence in terms of something happening terrible in his life that anyone has ever faced, and you're going to hear that. So Levi comes down to, after he makes a call, he goes to his, goes back to his wife. As a matter of fact, he makes the call from where the wife is. The police ask him, the 911 operator does ask him, can you do CPR? And he says, no, she's dead. The blood is dried. She's been dead for a while. And I can't bear to touch her. I can't. Believe me, there would have been no need for CPR and no benefit to CPR at that point in time. They ask him, okay, can you go out to the front or something like that? And he goes, no, I can't leave her. I can't leave her. And he refuses to leave her side. When the first police officer gets there, an experienced long-term sergeant with the department, if he finds Levi, I believe, kneeling down, and the sergeant walks in, and Levi's back is to him. And I believe the sergeant will tell you that Levi's not even aware that the sergeant's there. Sergeant is just watching from a distance, and Levi is crying, and Levi is moaning, and Levi is asking why she would do this. How could you do this? Please wake up, baby. Please wake up. He may have even apologized. I'm sorry. After a few minutes, Sergeant Joseph makes Levi aware that he's there, and he, brings him out to the room. And eventually, several other police officers show up. And then after that, shows up the field investigator for the Office of the Medical Investigator. Now, these detectives that show, among the people that show up are Detective Aaron Jones and Sergeant Detective John Gordon. He's now a lieutenant. But these are very, very experienced officers. They look around at the scene. They look at everything. They have, I believe that Aaron Jones will tell you, he's looked at scenes where something originally looked like a suicide but was later determined to be murder. So these are not cops that don't know what the heck they're doing. These are experienced police officers. The house looks neat and orderly. They look at everything. They check out the entire situation. And they decide, yeah, looks like a suicide to us. Nothing out of place. Nothing that sticks out that would be like a telltale sign that, maybe this isn't suicide. Then the investigator from the Office of the Medical Investigator comes out. And you'll learn that as part of the duties of the Office of the Medical Investigator, they investigate every unattended death. And so they went out to the house, they took photographs, did all of the stuff they needed to do, and they bagged the body and they took it out. And so OMI does its own investigation, and they check out the scene. And OMI, Office of the Medical Investigator, is the agency for the state of New Mexico that is responsible for determining cause of death and manner of death in an unattended death. Okay? That's their job. And they looked at everything and they said, this is a suicide. Now, you can learn that, yes, Aaron Jones, and by the way, I think you're going to learn quite a bit about Aaron Jones. I suspect that you're going to find out a little bit about what makes him tick, a little bit about why he behaved the way he did in this case. But Aaron Jones goes and he tells the court of a family that their daughter is dead of an apparent suicide. Well, needless to say, the Cordova family, Tara's mother, Tara's father, Tara's two brothers, hate Levi and have pretty much always hated Levi. Levi doesn't go over and socialize in their house. They'd been to Levi and Tara's house maybe less than a handful of times during the course of the entire marriage, even though they had two grandchildren there. The animosity and the negative feelings run deep. Now, the witnesses may try to play that down a little bit when they come into court here from the court of a family, because they know that if they let their real feelings of the deep hatred show, that might bias their testimony in your eyes. So you're probably going to see a cleaned up, somewhat sanitized version of how the Cordovas feel about Levi, but the evidence is going to tell you something else, and the evidence is going to speak volumes. So of course, when the police get there, Tara's parents can't believe, oh no, there's no way she would have committed suicide. And eventually later, there's talk about, yeah, she was planning on opening a business. Well, you're going to learn from people very knowledgeable in the in particular, a witness of ours, we expect, if the case gets this far, we expect you to hear from Dr. Berman. Dr. Berman is the executive director of the National Board of Suicidology in Washington, D.C. He's a psychologist, a forensic psychologist with a special concentration and training in suicide. And you're going to learn it is not uncommon at all. In fact, it's very common that family members of someone who has committed suicide have a difficult, if not impossible, time accepting that their family member committed suicide for a variety of reasons. And I don't need to get into that now, but you'll hear from the witnesses. And so an investigation is launched. And the head of the investigation is Aaron Jones. And you're going to learn a few things about the way Aaron Jones conducted the investigation. It's kind of interesting that the state sort of broached that subject for you, maybe to kind of break the ice, because he knew what I was going to talk about. But you're going to learn that police officers, when they are interrogating or conducting interviews, have certain very, very basic rules to go by. In fact, they're so basic, they're common sense. You guys are gonna all know this without even having training as a police officer. As a police officer, when you're interviewing people, one big thing is you separate them. You don't interview them together at the same time, but you're going to see critical, crucial places where Aaron Jones did exactly that. For example, Nick Wheeler, who's the one that Tara was sleeping with, and who's also a police officer. Nick Wheeler's a buddy of Aaron Jones. Aaron Jones, because of the way his mind works, because of his personality, I believe that it's fair to say that you're going to find that Aaron Jones finds a conspiracy in practically everything he looks at, that other people might see something as fairly simple. But Aaron Jones, wanting to build himself up as some kind of world-class detective, will be the only one to spot something that nobody else can spot. And so, in this case, when Aaron Jones is conducting his investigation, not only does he interview people together, but you're going to learn also that one of the main common sense precepts of interviewing witnesses as a police officer is to ask open-ended questions, to talk to somebody and start finding out what they know. Ask open-ended questions so that you're not directing the exact course of the inquiry. Rather, you're allowing answers to come in, and then you formulate your next answer based upon what your interview subject tells you, so that you can go where the evidence leads you. That's the way police officers are trained to conduct interviews. That's one thing. The other thing is, of course, you don't start feeding them information about the case because you're trying to find out and go where the answers lead you, not force feed your version as a cop of what happened and try to break down witnesses until they accept your version. And that, you're going to find out, was Aaron Jones' style in this case and what he did. So you're going to find out that Aaron Jones told various different witnesses that Levi Chavez went out and changed his insurance policy just in weeks before his wife died. He went out and took out an insurance policy for $100,000 that would pay out in the case of suicide. He would tell the witnesses this stuff first, and that's just the tip of the iceberg. Well, you know what? That's a lie. And that's the same lie that the media has been perpetrating for 5.5 years. By the way, this investigation that I'm talking about took approximately 4 years, okay? So if you're sitting around wondering, wow, if she died in 2007, how come we're not getting to trial till 2013? Well, that's because the Valencia County Sheriff's Department and the New Mexico State Police and the New Mexico Insurance Fraud Bureau and the Albuquerque Police Department Internal Affairs Division and the FBI from 2007 till 2011, for 4 years, they scoured the earth and scorched the earth for every possible detail that they could find about the life of Levi Chavez. And so when you see the state come up with the evidence they got, that's all they got from all of these agencies over 4.5 years. So, you know, by the way, I'm going to skip to something real quick, and that's changing the cause of death on the autopsy. You're going to find out from Dr. McFeely that it was called a suicide because their own investigators, whose job it is to go and see what kind of death it is, called it a suicide. And all of the police officers at the time called it a suicide. And it was only after Aaron Jones went in there and provided her with stuff to be suspicious about. For example, he raised doubts as to whether these things that have been referred to as suicide notes, the one note that says, I'm sorry, Levi, the other torn up note, whether that, that those weren't real and that Levi had somehow, created notes that weren't really from Tara. Also, they had to come because Levi had a text on his phone from Tara's phone saying, I think I'm going to hurt myself. They have to come up with this big, elaborate plan that Levi somehow did this secret agent James Bond thing where he put spyware or malware on the phone, or he cloned a phone and was somehow able to nefariously make it look as though Tara had sent him this text. What a load. What ended up happening, let me tell you. Let me tell you. The state goes out and they hire a handwriting expert. And the state's own handwriting expert, paid for by the state, is a very, very knowledgeable, experienced investigator. In fact, he spent his entire career working as a questioned documents examiner for law enforcement. And when he retired, he went into private practice by himself, Thomas Van Valderburg, and well-known guy throughout the region, if not just the state of New Mexico. Well, surprise, surprise, and bummer for the state, the state's own expert comes back with a report and says, yes, indeed, Tara wrote those notes where she says that she's going to hurt herself, she's going to kill herself, etc. That is indeed Tara's handwriting. Of course, her family didn't want to believe it. Nobody wanted to believe it. But when the state goes out and pays taxpayer money to a guy to give them a report as to whose handwriting it is, oops, it's Tara's handwriting on those suicide notes. Then the state has the phones checked, okay? And the state expends lots and lots of effort. You're gonna find out that 1, 2, 3, 4 different experts, you know, may have up to that many, may have looked at the various computers. 1, 2, 3, 4, maybe up to that many experts looked at the phones, finally culminating in a report from an information technology expert from the Federal Bureau of Investigation. And guess what? Oops, the FBI says, no spyware on any of those phones, no malware. These phones were of an older generation where they couldn't even be cloned. And yes, sorry, DA's office, but that text message that Tara was going to kill herself went from Tara's phone to Levi's phone, and all your Jason Bourne, James Bond conspiracy theories, those are out the window now too. Then, okay, so we have a lie that's been perpetuated. By the way, you're going to wonder, how did this happen, and how did this case stay, just churning through the media for 4 years before Levi is even charged with anything? This is what happens, and you're going to learn this from Detective Aaron Jones. Detective Aaron Jones is going to tell you, well, you know something, I was involved in some lawsuits, and I know how civil discovery works. That's the process, about how the lawyers for each side obtain information to learn about their case. He's going to say, well, you know what, I talked it over with the Cordova family, and so they're getting a civil lawyer to sue for wrongful death. So the DA's office has for years already been, you know, looking up different experts and hiring people and seeing what they could come up with to try to cobble together a case that makes it look like Levi's guilty. And at the same time, there's this civil lawyer who's out for money damages, and he's out there collecting stuff, and of course he's got a lot of money to spend, and so he's hiring various experts and doing his various stuff, and they're all working together. All these agencies are all working together and sharing information to see if they can come up with something. Well, turns out the lie that they concocted about Levi changing his insurance policy, and this is why we wanted so much to know what you had heard about this case, because very damaging things for years have been leveled in the media regularly, prominently, in an effort to smear him, in an effort to poison the minds of who eventually became his jury. And you're his jury, and you promised us, and we believe you, that you will vote on this case based on the evidence produced here in court and nothing else. And the reason is because Levi never did change his insurance policy. That handwriting on those things, I guess we're not supposed to call them suicide notes, but those two writings, those are Tera's. The phone calls, those were Tera's phone calls. And you know, what is so nefarious about deleting a pestering wife who's calling you 315 times over the course of 2 days? Would you just let them rack up on your phone? At any rate, what you're going to find out is, so this is another media lie. Levi called down his APD buddies to help him come and destroy the crime scene. Okay? Now you're the jury and you're going to get to see what really happened. What really happened is that Aaron Jones comes in and he starts talking to Levi. And at some point, Aaron Jones says, you know what, we're going to call some people from your department to come down here. Not Levi asking for it. Sheriff's office, Valencia County Sheriff's Office. Levi doesn't want that. He says, no, I don't want anybody, any of them coming down here, please. I mean, imagine the state he's in. He has just discovered less than an hour earlier his wife lying there dead from an ugly gunshot, dead. No, you don't need to call anybody from my department. Well, yes, we do. We need to have them come down here. And it was your APD service weapon. And you're going to even hear Levi saying, well, why? If I worked at Walmart, would you bring down my Walmart supervisors? I mean, Levi really doesn't want APD guys going down there. But they show up anyway. There's a grief counselor, there's a psychologist, there's several people that show up. And you're going to find out that the removal of part of this bedding and part of the mattress was done under the complete supervision of the Valencia County Sheriff's Department, who was in charge of that scene. They supervised and permitted and were in agreement that the Albuquerque Police Department remove some of that bloody stuff so that the family wouldn't have to deal with that in the aftermath of everything else that was going on. So, Levi called his cop buddies to come down and destroy the crime scene. Yet another lie. You know, one more thing. In all the years that this investigation has gone on, they've been trying to figure out, okay, well, when could Levi have killed her? You know, he was at work. When he was at work at APD until midnight, he was there riding in the same car with another police officer who was there with him the whole time. He was out there on the west side, the other police officer riding with him. You have to understand that typically it's one man to a car. That's the way APD is. One officer to a car. You don't have a second cop riding with you unless they're a fairly new cop and are going through some on-the-job training. And then they have a time period that they have to ride with somebody. Also, when you're a fairly new cop, you don't have your own cop car yet sometimes. And so this guy riding with him didn't have his own cop car, and so he would be Levi's passenger as Levi drove during the course of his work day being a cop. Well, Levi couldn't have taken off and snuck off and hightailed it down to Las Lunas to kill his wife because the other cop wouldn't have had, you know, his driver in a cop car to be in. And so we know that Levi was at work the whole time he was supposed to be at work. And then Levi told the police in several conversations. Levi went in several times voluntarily, didn't clam up and say, hey man, you think you got something on me? You prove it. I'm remaining silent. I'm getting a lawyer. My lawyer, I'm not saying anything, period. He didn't do that. He did what we would expect an innocent man to do. Poor guy. He thinks that this is all going to be cleared up in a few days. So he supplies them more and more information to show them, you know, what happened. And he gives them Deborah Romero's telephone number. And he gives them credit card receipts of where he was that whole day, going from place to place with Deborah Romero. And you're going to find out from Deborah Romero that she thought Levi was kind of immature, the opposite of some kind of criminal mastermind, that she thought, you know, he wasn't all that super intelligent and wasn't very, you know, worldly at all. Even gave examples of that. But she is going to say that, you know, he acted completely normal, wasn't behaving in any sort of odd way, nervous way, guilty-looking way, the whole day that he was out there going to the movies, to a restaurant, various places with her, that he seemed perfectly, perfectly normal. By the way, as part of the investigation, they got all of Levi's psychological records from when he became a police officer at all the various agencies. And you're not going to hear anything about Levi's a psychopath or Levi's got some kind of really effective criminal mind where he can act like everything is fine and dandy even though he just murdered his wife in cold blood. You're not going to hear anything of the sort. But you can bet that every aspect of Levi's life has been gone over and over and over with the entire staff of however many dozens upon dozens of lawyers, the DA's, I don't know if the entire staff worked on the case, but the DA's office has got dozens of lawyers, okay? And then we've got the civil lawyer and his lead investigator and his paralegal and his expert witnesses and all of that stuff. So there has been a big, big concerted effort to try to find something. So anyway, let's talk a little bit more about Deborah Romero and Jones. Jones tells them this lie about the insurance policy. Jones tells the various witnesses that he's trying to supposedly interview. He's acting more as an agent of propaganda than an investigator trying to find information out. He's giving false information out in hopes that he can get somebody to say something bad about Levi. And so he goes so far as to show Deborah Romero and Rose Slama and others, not only is he telling them all this stuff that isn't true at all, and I'm going to call him on it. We'll see how what he has to say about that. But he actually shows them these gruesome, bloody photographs that the Office of the Medical Investigator took, that the Sheriff's Department took, the photographs that we took pains to ask each of you, would you feel okay? Can you look at those and still be able to be fair and impartial in this case? Well, Aaron Jones wasn't about fair and impartial. He shows them all of these photographs. Look, look at what he did, you know? And then he goes so far as to make up a bunch of more malarkey. He tells Deborah Romero, and he tells Rose Slama, and he tells other people, look at the blood flows on this gun. And notice these unusual blood flows, and notice how there are voids on the handle, and this and that, and he's trying to suggest that there's something suspicious about the photographs and the way the gun looks, and that proves that Levi is guilty. Well, another oops for the DA's office. The DA's office goes out and hires again their own crime scene reconstruction expert. And the DA's office gives them a series of questions of things that that their office want the crime scene investigators to look at and investigate. And one of the very first ones, if not the first one, is unusual blood flows. Well, the state's own expert, Art Ortiz, looks at that, examines the whole thing, comes back, and in a written report says, I don't find any unusual blood flows. The woman was shot, and she was sitting like this when she was first shot, and at some point shortly thereafter, her body slumped, and so the gravity made the blood go this way at one point, made the blood go this way at another point. And there are no unusual blood flows. And then, the state's own expert writes on his report, and therefore, I refute the state's theory that there was tampering with evidence because of any supposed unusual blood flows. There are no unusual blood flows. And then they had questions about, oh, is there something weird or funny about where the gun landed? He writes in his report, no. There's nothing weird or funny about the way the gun landed. Is there something funny or weird about where the bullet casing is? No, there's nothing funny or weird about where the bullet casing is. In question after question, just like the state's handwriting expert didn't come through for their theory of suicide, the state's crime scene reconstruction expert is saying, and this is an expert, is basically saying when there's no unusual blood flows, that Aaron Jones was a dishonest, lying cop when he goes around telling witnesses, trying to break them down, trying to get them to say things that aren't true, lies, like the unusual blood flows. But it doesn't end there. You see, Aaron Jones, and by the way, Levi doesn't say alibi. Levi never uses the word alibi. What Levi does is answer the officer's questions. And the officer says, where were you? And he says, I was with, you know, this woman. I was with her all fucking weekend. And he is dropping F-bombs left and right. He has just found his wife dead. Who are we to judge how a person reacts to that? But he's dropping a lot of F-bombs. And so, Aaron Jones asks him, who did this? Asks him, what's her name? What's her name? And he says, Deborah. And then he says, she'll fucking freak. This is the last thing I wanted to get her caught up in, or words to that effect. Because he realizes now that the woman he was having an affair with, who is herself a police officer, thought they could keep the affair secret, is now a critical witness in a murder investigation. Oh man, does he feel terrible. First of all, he feels extremely terrible, and you're gonna hear this throughout the thing, for what happened to Tara. And he's blaming himself for not being a good husband. He was a good father. For not being a good husband, for not being there when Tara needed him. He laments the fact that Tara supported him and loved him through thick and thin. And he's just beating himself up something fierce. So, and he says this to Detective Jones, and I believe Sergeant John Gordon is with him at the time. Well, here's what these cops do. This is reprehensible. I suppose there's a small chance that they didn't know what they were doing. You guys can judge that. But Aaron Jones goes, and let me explain something. He talks to Deborah Romero, and Deborah Romero says, yeah, he spent the weekend with me. Yeah, he got off work around midnight. Yeah, he would come to my house, and he would get there shortly after midnight. You know, he'd get there just in the time it took to drive from the west side of town, APD, West Side Area Command, or whatever it's called, over to her house in the Northeast Heights. And he would get there. And Deborah Romero tells the police, yeah, both nights, came over, got there shortly after he got off work. First night, we just, went to bed. The next day, we kind of lounged around, hung around the house. In the afternoon, he had to go to work again. He went to work. He got off at midnight. He came to my house again, spent the night. The next day we went, you know, to the movies, to the restaurant, various places like that. Okay, well, Aaron Jones starts thinking this isn't gonna work. He's an alibi. Now here's something you gotta know. Aaron Jones has decided to make himself a soldier whose only cause apparently is Tera Chavez. And you're gonna learn that in his office, he has one of the walls of his office covered in photographs of Tera Chavez. Not the other cases he's working or supposed to be working on, just Tera Chavez. And on the other wall, he's got pictures with him arm in arm with Nick Wheeler, the guy Tera was having sex with. Because it turns out that Aaron Jones and Nick Wheeler are buddy-buddy. I mean, so buddy-buddy that in Aaron Jones's office, there's a picture of Nick Wheeler and Aaron Jones arm in arm. Nick Wheeler was listed as a witness for Aaron Jones in one of Aaron Jones's cases. Nick Wheeler, he's the guy that gets interviewed by Aaron Jones with his wife right there. Of course, Aaron Jones is buddies with the wife too, and it's, oh, hi, honey, how are you doing, smooch, smooch, and everything, and it's all a big, happy, friendly thing. So, what happens is that, and I haven't gotten to it yet, Aaron Jones goes and he tells Deborah Romero, you know what, this guy that you thought he was going to be your boyfriend, right? And she goes, yeah, we were kind of headed in that direction, and it was going to be maybe, you know, a relationship that was going to last, right? Well, yeah, well, let me tell you something. He was sleeping with X number of other women at the same time, you know, look at these body flows, la-da-da. He's telling her all this kind of stuff to get her to change her mind, and then he even tells her, and you know what else? You know what? He didn't even know your name. He referred to you, Aaron Jones, talking about my client, Levi. This is what he tells Deborah Romero, because he got to try to break down that alibi. Aaron Jones tells Deborah Romero, you know what? He didn't even know your name. He just called you some fucking freak. And he repeats it several times. Yeah, that boyfriend of yours that you thought you were going to develop a romantic relationship with, he just thinks you're just some fucking freak. And I can back that up, he says. Well, he can't back it up, because in the recording it is crystal clear that what Levi said is, she'll fucking freak. This is the last thing I would want to get her caught up in. But Aaron Jones is a dirty, dishonest police officer. And you're going to, hopefully you're going to learn more. That's going to be up to the judge, but we'll see what you get to hear about. Now, let's talk about Rose Slamma, because that's another doozy. Rose Slamma, let me finish with Deborah Romero, okay? So she says all of this stuff and admits it, and she even says that Levi was at her house and got there shortly after she went to sleep. Got there shortly after he got off work. That's when Levi got to Deborah Romero's house. And she also goes on. She's asked in the earlier interviews, well, could he have gotten there as late as 1? Could he have gotten there as late as 3 in the morning? She goes, no way. No way, because of the way I sleep. Because of my sleeping habits, first of all, I wasn't asleep way back in my bed. I was asleep on the couch by the front door. I was waiting for Levi. And if he hadn't shown, if hours had gone by and he hadn't shown up, I would have awoken and wondered, where the hell is Levi? So, you know, I know that. Well, eventually, over time, they finally get Deborah Romero, after she's so mad at Levi, after she thinks that Levi is calling her a fucking freak, after she thinks that Levi doesn't know her name, after she's told all of these lies. Kind of wonder, can't police investigate a case by just asking what happened? maybe telling the truth. Anyway, finally she says that, okay, I don't know exactly what time it was when he came in. And then the lawyers, because this comes from the civil lawsuit, the lawyers say, okay, so, but you know, she said, I know it's still dark. No, it's still dark. So he could have come in as late as 6:30 in the morning or whenever the sun rose. And so that's where the civil lawyers suing for money and the army of various law enforcement agencies are all, oh boy, yippee, we've got a window of opportunity now. Problem is, Deborah Romero is not going to deny, I don't think, unless she's been turned around some more, she's not going to deny that she would expect Levi to be there shortly after work, that if he had come in much later than that, she would have woken up because of where she's sleeping and because of her usual sleep patterns, that she tends to wake up when if she's expecting somebody and they're not there. But that's not all, because check this out. The police and the various experts and everybody who's trying to put a case together to say, can we find something to hang Levi with this? What they do is, of course, they get all the cell phone records. We've talked about that. But then they go further. They go to Verizon, and they get what's called cell phone tower information. And that's where experts in this area can look at telephone calls. And I think it may be called triangulation or something. And you get a pretty decent idea of where a telephone was when it either received a call or made a call. Or as I understand it, even if the phone's turned off, if somebody's trying to call your phone while your phone's off, that will leave a certain mark, and that will show what cell phone tower the call bounced off of. So the DA's office, I assume, or the investigators, or whoever's doing this, going, okay, now we're gonna get him. Because now we're going to show from his cell phone information that he snuck on down to Las Lunas at some point and murdered his wife and then snuck on back before anybody was the wiser. Well, another big oops for the DA's office. Because what you're going to find out is that the cell phone records, like everything else in this case, back up Levi's story completely. And it shows that Levi left Las Lunas when he was, said he left Las Lunas, came and went to work, and we got cell phone towers pinging, going from Las Lunas to the west side and staying on the west side where he's supposed to be working. And then shortly after midnight, the cell phone records ping all the way up to Deborah Romero's house where they stay there all night. And the same thing happens the next day. And Levi Chavez doesn't start heading down according to the cell phone tower information, because now we're getting really sophisticated here after years of investigation. The cell phone tower information shows that Levi doesn't get down to Las Lunas until approximately 8:12 p.m. on Sunday. That's when he gets there. That's when he said he went down there, when he went to his mom's house. And he started worrying a little bit when he asked his mom if she had heard from Tara, and she hadn't. And he found out that she called in sick on the Saturday and then never went in at all on the Sunday. So dang it, they've tried to prove it with the insurance policy. Whoops, that didn't pan out. They tried to prove that Levi somehow wrote the suicide notes. Whoops, their own expert says, nope. Tara wrote them. They tried to show that Levi actually snuck on down through cell phone records. Their own experts that they consulted say, whoops, Levi was where he said he was the whole entire time during this whole four-day time period. They tried to show that that Levi must have done some secret agent man thing to make it look as though Tera had sent him a text. Well, the FBI says, nope, Tera sent him that text, saying she's going to kill herself. Let's talk just for a second about a couple more things. And the main thing is Rose Slama. Rose Slama is a liar, and you're going to hear witnesses who have known her for a long time, had enough time to form an opinion as to whether she's an honest or a dishonest person. Opinion, dishonest. You're going to find something else out that's very interesting. Rose Slama is one of the people that was talked to by Aaron Jones time after time after time. Rose Slama was asked many times in many of these statements that she gave in 2007 and 2008 questions about Levi's truck. Perfect opening to say, if it were really true, that one day when I was getting a haircut, Tera turned to me and said, you know what? That truck wasn't really stolen. Levi's doing an insurance scam. What a crock. And that then, second lie, that Rose later went and told Levi, gee, your wife thinks you may have something to do with this. And that is the reason why Levi, oh, my wife thinks I stole a truck. Oh, I'm going to murder her. That's the state's theory. So anyway, given many opportunities, Rose has given many opportunities to talk about the truck. She's asked about the truck. I'm going to show you where she's asked about the truck. She's going to be cross-examined about that stuff. Not once does she say anything about Tera supposedly telling her the truck wasn't really stolen. And then, on November 3rd, 2010, Rose Slama gets charged with larceny over $2,500. That's a third-degree felony. That's a crime of dishonesty. Stealing, thievery, dishonesty. She's not charged with, not having an elk hunting permit or some other kind of felony. She's charged with lying felony. Remember this date, November 3rd, 2010, because then 8 days later, November 11th, 2010, Rose Slama is called in to give a story again. And lo and behold, after she herself is charged with felonies, Rose Slama gives a whole new story for the very first time. Rose Slama says, oh, you know what, by the way, must have slipped my mind. One time I was getting a haircut, and Tera told me that the truck wasn't really stolen and that Levi was behind it. And then later I told Levi that. Well, the funny thing is that in all of these previous telephone calls and previous interviews that Rose Slama has had, Rose actually makes surreptitious tape-recorded phone calls to Levi with the cops right there, see what you can get out of him, you know? And Levi tells her, tell the truth. And she goes, well, I'm really worried because these cops are asking me a bunch of questions and I don't know what to tell them. Tell them the truth. You're going to hear that every time. Every time she talks to Levi, Levi's advice to her is, tell the truth. Okay? So then after she gets charged with that, then later in 2011, so now Rose Slama has made a statement under oath, a lie under oath, that Tera said to her that Levi didn't, that the truck wasn't really stolen, it was an insurance scam. Well then, later in 2011, in August, Rose Slama gets indicted on three counts of failure to disclose information in order to obtain public assistance, or, in short, welfare fraud. She is charged with having committed welfare fraud in July of 2008, July of 2009, July of 2010, and so now she's had a second time where a grand jury has met and decided there's probable cause to believe that she's committed crimes of dishonesty, welfare fraud, more lying crimes. So then, she's not done, because in 2012, in Albuquerque, she's charged with more felonies. Guess what kind of felonies? Fraud, forgery, identity theft, lying, cheating felonies. So, you don't think that Rose Slama has a motive to say things that's going to make the district attorney's office happy? And I'm going to tell you, the district attorney's office did what they're obligated to do, and they passed the case off to a different district attorney's office to avoid conflict of interest, so they're not directly prosecuting the woman who's now been charged with her third set of felonies involving lying, their star witness. But the issue and the question you have to decide is, you know, why would it be that she would give a completely different story about the truck for the first time 8 days after she's charged with her first set of felonies? And why would she keep it up? Well, I'll tell you why she would keep it up, because them felonies are racking up. Then she got a second set of felonies, then she got a third set of felonies. And remember, she made a statement under oath. You want to throw perjury in there and make a fourth set of felonies? So Rose is kind of stuck there. I think when this case is over, you're going to have ample evidence to have substantial doubts about what Rose Slama has to say. The medication, the over-the-counter medication that Tara had taken, had acetaminophen and diphenhydramine. We call that commonly Tylenol and Benadryl. That's what it had. And the doctors are going to tell you that, oh, the amount she had in her system, according to the tests, the toxicology tests, at the time of the autopsy, would not have knocked her out, would not have doped her up. They would have been enough to make her sleepy, but not enough to render her unconscious. And more importantly, specifically, you're going to learn that the Benadryl that she had in her system at the time absolutely would not have doped her up to the extent that she would not be able to resist a gun being placed clear far into the back of her mouth. And the gun was placed clear far in the back of her mouth. And you're going to see the size of the muzzle on that gun, okay? So if somebody forced a gun into her mouth against her will, she would have and could have, we would expect her to have resisted. And had she resisted, there would be evidence of injuries to the inside of her mouth, to her tongue, to her palate, and perhaps broken teeth, none of that. What you're going to hear from the pathologist is that the injury to her mouth was the classic intraoral gunshot wound injury. And we're going to hear a little bit about what that is. In other words, the only injury she got to her mouth, the inside of her mouth, was the injury one would expect from a gunshot wound, and nothing else was found. And the pathologist that took the autopsy is going to tell you that there is no evidence, that all of the evidence of the autopsy is consistent with suicide, and that none of the evidence of the autopsy points toward homicide. None of it. For example, if there had been some injuries inside up here to her palate or to her tongue or something that might indicate that somebody else tried to put a gun in her mouth, and she goes, whoa, whoa, what's going on? Wait, stop. Would have turned her head, would have done something, and there would be some evidence to show that. She had long manicured fingernails that were undisturbed, no DNA, no debris of any kind under her fingernails. Even if it's your own husband, if you wake up and something cold metal is being shoved down the back of your mouth, are you going to do something? Are you going to even unconsciously, involuntarily resist somehow? And there's none of that. None. Zero. It's 100% wholly consistent with suicide. Now, if we get that far, oh, by the way, you're right. The DA's right. Lots more tests we ran. I'm not going to touch on all of them. But, for example, Rose Slama tells the police officers when they're showing her various photographs of things, and oh yes, these are the shorts, the sweatpants that he would always wear. And when we were done having sex, he would always take them off and throw them in the shower like clockwork. Excuse me, throw them in the washing machine like clockwork. And so, there's sweatpants there. They get the sweatpants. They see what they refer to as some discharge. They think, aha, we're going to have Levi's DNA. Now we got him. Well, labs tested. DNA is Tara's DNA. No Levi DNA. But even more important, they find a hair. A human male hair in the sweatpants that have Tara's DNA. And the male hair does not belong to Levi Chavez. So some other guy's hair, along with Tara's DNA, were in those pants. And no Levi DNA, no Levi hair. You know, they tested this stuff that was found under the bed, a diary, some marijuana, I'm sorry, under the mattress, between the mattresses, wherever it was found, that Mr. McKay referred to. Tested that for fingerprints. No Levi fingerprints. Not on the diary, not on the notes that they found torn up, not on the marijuana. In fact, the evidence is going to show Levi didn't smoke marijuana. Tera Chavez did smoke marijuana. That's pretty much not in dispute. Marijuana is not what this case is about, but that was one of the things found. But Levi's fingerprints weren't on any of that either, so once again, bummer for the DA's office. When we get down this far to the defense portion of the case, if we have to, you're not only going to hear from our expert in suicides, and size him up yourself. Size him up. You decide whether he's believable or whether he's a quack or whether he's got the credentials and the knowledge. Because he's the author of numerous books and published publications. He has testified before congressional committees in Washington, D.C. numerous times, et cetera, et cetera. You're going to hear from our forensic pathologist, an MD whose job it was working for the Office of the Medical Investigator in several different locations. And when he worked at the Office of the Medical Investigator in Dade County, Florida, he was specifically called upon to look at cases to determine was this a suicide or was it a homicide. He has worked, just like every expert we're going to be calling here, has worked for decades as a law enforcement officer to find the truth. And what they're doing in this case for Levi is no different. But the truth is that Levi is innocent. And that's what their testimony will show you. And so when you hear from Dr. Wetley, you're going to hear that he was charged with the duty of determining that he has personally conducted thousands upon thousands upon thousands of autopsies. He has personally been present, attended at the scene of well over 1,000 deaths.
So not just in the cold laboratory setting, but actually at the scene where it took place. And he's going to give you his medical opinion. And he believes that this is not a murder. And he's going to tell you about a case. He's going to tell you about another law enforcement officer, a sergeant, who's now doing time in prison because this same expert viewed the evidence in that case and said, yep, this guy tried to make it look like a suicide, but and even though he was a high-ranking, experienced officer, nope, there are inconsistencies here. There are little things that are sticking out of place, and I say this is a murder, and he so testified in a court of law, and that man is doing time. Well, that same expert looked at this case and came to a different conclusion. You're also going to hear from Larry McCann. Larry McCann is an extremely experienced and credited, lauded crime scene analyst and crime scene reconstructionist. Larry McCann was asked by Janet Reno, when she was the Attorney General for the United States of America, to help write a book on crime scene analysis. That book, which was in part authored by the witness you're going to hear from, was published by the United States Department of Justice. Larry McCann is going to tell you that he examined this case in every possible detail, and that he is convinced to a reasonable degree of scientific and medical scientific certainty that this scene is consistent with a suicide, and equally as importantly, inconsistent with a homicide.
Now, two things about this seated firearm.
You're going to learn that several people, several experts in firearms have looked at the photographs of that gun from all the various positions and cannot say that the gun was unseated. Unseated means the magazine or the clip isn't put all the way in to where it's locked into position like it needs to be for the gun to reload another bullet into the chamber after having fired the first one, okay? So that is something that seems a little peculiar until you look at a couple of things. Number one, the only person who says that that gun was unseated is, guess who? Aaron Jones. And the state's expert and our experts and all of the experts are going to say they can't say the gun looks unseated because the fact of the matter is a Glock. In fact, the state's own expert, Mark Radosovich, is going to tell you that he himself carried a Glock for several years and that he knows the magazine sticks out of the, even when fully seated, the magazine end sticks out from the handle or grip more than does the average gun, and so to the untrained eye, it might look as though it's unseated. And you're going to learn that not one single other witness, not any law enforcement officer, not any civilian, not any medical personnel, nobody is going to corroborate Aaron Jones' notion that the gun was unseated. And furthermore, no physical evidence, no photographs, no other testing done, nothing else is going to corroborate Aaron Jones' sole claim that the gun was unseated. The only thing that makes this seem suspicious is that the gun, according to Aaron Jones, was unseated. But nobody is backing up Aaron Jones, and no physical evidence is backing up Aaron Jones on that point. But Larry McCann goes a step further. He says, okay, let's presume for the sake of argument that the gun wasn't fully seated when police found it. Now, how do you explain a situation where the gun is fired around, the gun has rechambered around, and the magazine is not fully seated? So Aaron Jones goes out and he gets a Glock, and he gets a Glock that is this model 17 9mm, and it's a different generation, but you're going to see that the magazine release button is exactly the same on the, and it's the same make, same model, same magazine release button. Larry McCann goes out and sees how this gun operates. And he makes a video, and on the video, you see Larry McCann shooting the gun, pulling the trigger, and the hand, and if the finger goes back, or the digit used to pull the trigger goes back, it can go across and hit that magazine release button after the gun has already chambered another round, hits the magazine release button, and it becomes partially unseated. And you're going to hear that that could have happened when the gun fell. It could have hit the remote control. It could have hit her wrist or her knuckle. It could have hit anything and become partially unseated. And so there is far from proof beyond a reasonable doubt. You're going to find that there are lots of ways that that gun could have found itself in that position. And in fact, Mark Radosovich is going to agree. He's going to say, well, yes, it can be done. And I'm going to say, well, matter of fact, Mr. Radosovich, you watched the video where Larry McCann did it, right there on the video, didn't you? He's going to say yes. Because what Tara did, and what the expert's opinion is that Tara was holding that gun with her right hand upside down with her thumb on the trigger. And she was scared to death. And she wanted to know whether she had the nerve to do it or not. And she violently pulled that trigger with her thumb, pushed the trigger. And as she was doing that, her thumb continued to travel forward, hit the magazine release button, and as the gun fell on the bed, it got in that position. Either that, or maybe this is just yet one more in a string of places where you gotta ask yourself, do I really want to buy what Aaron Jones has to say? By the way, the autopsy was changed because Aaron Jones went with his, Patty McFeely, I expect she's gonna tell you, well, we were given more information, that the cause of death was now kind of in dispute. Okay, what was that new information? Well, we didn't write it down. Okay, so you changed the manner of death on an autopsy based on new information. What is that new information? Don't know. You don't know? No. Why not? Didn't write it down. Okay. But what you're going to learn is that it's all of these piles of lies that we've been ticking our way through during this opening statement. I have more to say, but I've been up here talking a long time, and you heard from the DA for a long time, and all I'm going to ask you to do is keep an open mind. Listen to this evidence very carefully. Do not be swayed by the emotions that you're going to hear, and focus on what kind of proof there is in this case. Because if you do that, ladies and gentlemen, Levi and I are confident that you're going to come back with the only verdict you can come back with, and that is not guilty.